Hello, we're here. We're doing the video thing. And pretty soon, hopefully now, people will start calling because the lines are, in fact, open. Okay? And I hope you will all join us and try to call. We especially would like people who've never called before. We're very good about that. Okay? We like to have people call us who've never called before. But now, see, here's the part that's embarrassing for me, is that I now have to wait for people to call. And so I'm just sitting here talking and hoping and praying that people will call. The Skype lines are open, folks, and you can call me, and you can call me right now. At GABNet Live. That's GABNet Live. I repeat, GABNet Live. Okay? Why is nobody calling? Am I going to sit here and have to pretend like nothing's wrong? Like Patrick said, he'd like to call tonight, but there's a football game on he wants to watch. And I think it's his home team versus the San Francisco 49ers, so I guess I'll root for the 49ers, and he can root for the home team. But anyway, we're waiting for your calls. Where's Scott? Where's Phil? Where's everybody? See, I wish I didn't. Here's what happens. People do not call immediately, and I'm stuck. Oh, there we go. There's Rob. Okay. We finally have somebody. Hello, Rob. How are you?
Good, Alex. How are you?
Yeah, I'm fine. Thank you. And good evening to you. Rob is down in Virginia.
Yeah, there you go.
I got it.
That's right.
Rob is in Virginia, and we are very happy with Rob. Is like one of our family here.
I have a new member of my family here.
What do you mean? Oh, you got a new kitty?
Mm-hmm.
See, that's the reason we have the TV thing going here.
His name is Jack.
His name is Jack? And what kind of cat is he?
He's a baby ragdoll.
It's another ragdoll.
Mm-hmm.
You're big on the ragdolls.
Well, I already have one, and I figured they're both the same temperament. And right now, my older ragdoll, who's 11, is not taking to this very well. We have to keep them separate.
Oh, you know something? Don't worry about that. I got a new kitty, and I had another cat, I had another Siamese cat, and he immediately saw the little kitty and charged at the kitty. And we got frightened, and we picked up the kitty, and we put the kitty back in the cage she came in, okay? Mm-hmm. And she stayed there for 3 weeks, because every time we would open it up and the kitty would come out, our cat would start to growl and do all of that. And finally, one day, I said, I am sick and tired of this crap. And I opened up the thing, and the kitty came out, and the other kitty, the big cat, charged at the little kitty, and the little kitty took a swipe at the cat's nose, and he went running in the other direction.
That's not how it's working in this case, though. Well, it seems that the big one is fearful of this one, and is causing her lots of grief, lots of vomiting, just like paranoia. She won't eat. So we've been keeping them separate. And what I've been doing is this one stays in our bedroom, and the other one has the run of the house. And then we site swap, like, for about 3 hours a day. We'll move them and change so that they get used to each other's scents. And like tonight, I had Maxie, the other one, with me in the bedroom. We were watching the baseball game, mm-hmm. and then the game ended, and I wanted to come in here and bring the little guy, Jack, in here and go on GABNet with him. Mm-hmm. And Maxie came back up the stairs, and as soon as she, by that time, Jack was in the studio with the door closed. As soon as she sniffed under the door, she smelled the kitten, and she took off running downstairs. So she's like all kinds of anxiety, and so it's different than, the attack thing. And it's caused her not to eat, so I'm a little bit worried. She went for a couple of days. She's finally eating again because we're separated.
Listen, there's no such thing as a hunger strike with an animal.
Yeah.
I mean,
But she did hiss at him. She hissed at him one day.
Hold that kitty up above the frame so the people can see the kitty. Oh, look at that. Is that a cute kitten?
Biggest blue eyes. He's adorable. He really is sweet.
Now, are they expensive?
He was $850.
$850? Mm-hmm. Oh, boy. That's a lot of money to pay for a cat.
Yeah, I guess, but they're just such a good breed.
How much was the other one?
$750, 11 years ago.
So it's kind of, this cat is kind of the EpiPen of cats.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's gone up $100 in the 11 years. A different breeder, but.
Yeah, do they have papers?
Yep, he's a Tika.
What do you mean, a Tika?
It stands for something cat organization. He's recognized as a pedigreed cat.
So, yeah. But you don't want to show him or anything. It doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't matter.
And speaking of lovable animals, here's Phil Meyer.
Hey. Good evening. And so now what are you going to do? Get rid of Fluffy the dog and substitute the cat in the commercial?
There's no dog here.
Hey, if you squeeze the cat, does it make noise?
No?
Usually purrs like crazy.
That's very cute.
How long have you had the cat?
We got him last Saturday.
Last Saturday. Okay, so, I mean, was it when you first got it home, did it hide under beds and things like that?
Not him.
No?
No, this little guy is a rambunctious little guy. He's not afraid of anything.
Really?
It's the boy. The 11-year-old is the girl and much more timid.
Oh, really?
Okay. This guy, he's not afraid of anything. He'll go to anybody. He'll talk to anybody. He'll go in any room.
The best cat I ever had was a cat I called Shabbos. And he was a Siamese. And we got him from some woman who had to get rid of the cat. So he was about 6 months old.
Mm-hmm.
And she came to bring the cat. And she said, and we were prepared for the fact that the cat would probably hide for a week or whatever, you know, and finally learn to be with us.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as she brought the cat in, he jumped on my lap. And as she walked out the door, it was like he was waving goodbye.
Oops, Shabbos. You want to get down?
Isn't it Shabbos tonight?
Shabbos tonight. It's Friday night. It's Shabbos.
I'll let you down.
That's a great city.
He's 2.5 pounds. He's 3 months old. He'll be 20 pounds or so.
Wow. And is it the same kind of cat as your other one?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, both ragdolls. And then I figured because they're not an aggressive breed, you got to be careful when you want to bring another cat in the house. If you don't know where you get it, what kind of aggression it has. And now that I know how paranoid the adult one is, to the point where, you know, it's better that we got another mellow cat. Although you should see this little guy run around and play. There's nothing mellow about the way he jumps and runs and throws himself. It's fun. It's fun to play.
I was always amazed that cats live to be a year old because they're like running around and they're falling and slamming into walls.
Unbelievable. They with such abandon they play and they throw themselves. They just give up their bodies. Wham! And all you hear is boom! They just walk away and keep playing.
Wow. Oh, wait a minute. Here comes James Lee from Hawaii. Hello, James.
Oh, it's Aloha, James.
Aloha. Aloha, James.
Yes. How's it going, Mr. Bennett? I'm sorry, I got a bunch of dogs barking out here.
Yeah, well, we got a cat here, but they're not close to each other. So show everybody, this is Friday night. Show everybody your backyard in Hawaii. Look at that. It's a jungle out there. It's a jungle.
My truck back there. Uh-huh. That's my vehicle. I'm on a gravel road, so, you know, you can't have a nice, Corolla or anything. You got to bottom out here in the country.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. No, it's a jungle. That's why we're working out here right now. You can see the truck there, and let's see over here. There's a papaya tree there or something with some green papayas up there.
What a great Hawaiian resident you are. It's a papaya tree or something.
Yeah. Yeah, right there. They're kind of green up there.
Yeah.
Well, he's a transplanted San Franciscan, so you got to give him some slack.
Yeah. Okay, doggies. Fran, it's Uncle Alex, doggies. Uncle Alex. I know. You see the clock there? It's about 20 minutes to 5 coming up here.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. Isn't that cool?
Yeah, it's not the jungle.
Hey, well, what a great way to start the show. Come on, more people call. Come on, we want to fill this whole thing up.
Yesterday, tonight, we were talking about the To Catch a Predator. So today I talked with a friend of mine who's currently with the district attorney's office. And he said that it's perfectly legal what they're doing. And it's called specific intent. And specific intent is prosecutable. And the victim in the case of California crime would be the people of the state of California.
Okay, what I was saying last night is when they had these shows where they'd have like a 25-year-old woman passing as a 14-year-old girl. And then this guy would come over with chocolates for a date. Mm-hmm. They would arrest him. And I said, how can you arrest him? Because he's not coming on to a 14-year-old. He's coming on to a 25-year-old.
Right.
And
but
I still find it wrong.
You find it wrong, but the law says that it's called specific intent.
That's a bullshit law.
And the victim is the people of the state of California or whatever state the guy is in. And this is the way those sex crime things work. And my friend who did it, he was a sex crimes investigator at Richmond before he retired. And he was also, I worked with him for many years. He's the only other Jewish cop in the PD. And then, he's agreed to come over next week and talk to you about it.
Yeah, but I just find that something creepy and wrong about that. I mean, if a guy is going to come on to a young girl, let it be a real case of it happening, and then stop it before nip it in the bud. You know,
he was affiliated with that show when they did some things in Richmond, and Catch a Predator, and so he's very familiar with it. As well as he said that most of the perpetrators plead guilty. And he said, and they all get prosecuted, but many of them just plead guilty.
That's not what I heard. What I heard was that the rate of them being able to prosecute was very, very low.
Well, he said that that's not correct. I told him that you said that.
Well, he's not correct.
All right, but he was right there in the fray.
Why am I supposed to believe somebody from the district attorney's office?
Well, now he's retired. He's with the San Francisco District Attorney's Office.
Yeah.
he's doing a double dip pension.
Yeah.
Well, what I'm
he's
saying.
He's got that 3%, Mr.
Yeah, 3 at 50. Yeah, exactly.
He's making more money now out of pocket than he was working. He's more than 110%. I know about that.
Yeah.
Well, wait a minute. If you're a cop and then you retire, what is the pension?
Well, at 30 years, it's 90%.
90% for every year served.
Yeah, I think Steve had 25 years because he was with Porterville for 7 years, and then he came to he was at least 20 with Richmond. So
and he gets a cost of living too.
Yeah.
Every year, cost of living.
Yeah, plus medical and all those things. So that's a PERS retirement, and then the district attorney's office is a different retirement.
I work in San Mateo, and I got a
deal, Rob? Oh, you got that kind of deal, James?
Yeah, I when I came back from Vietnam, I worked for San Mateo County just for 3 years, a small job. Before I went back to UC Berkeley, mm-hmm. I was only making about $600 a month. Okay, and I was vested immediately into the system. So
really?
I went back. Yeah, after 3 years, I left to go back to grad school. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I left the money in, 30 years go by, and that $400 a month now, they're paying me almost $800 a month right now for the rest of my life, plus the cost of living.
Wow. I never worked that much after stations back in the day, but I did enough that I get like a $900 a month pension from my union, And had I worked all those years at AFTRA stations, I would be getting several thousand dollars a month.
Wow.
Have to stay alive. We can't drop dead on them. That's all right.
Yeah.
Leave
that money on the table.
One of the best pensions is like the Writers Guild.
Oh, yeah.
I knew a guy at the Letterman show who had to actually quit as a writer when he hit 60, which was when I think they can start getting their pension. Because if he didn't, he couldn't start getting his pension and he would lose all that money.
That's right. Yeah,
and the money was like, I don't know, 10 grand a month or something, 20 grand a month.
Expenditures. Do it. Live.
Yeah.
Same thing with our required minimum withdrawals on our IRAs. That all those folks that are over 71, we've got to take down our IRA. If I don't give it away to charity because I don't need it, or, or take care of the family or charity, you know, it just is increase your expenditures. Get it, buy another dog.
Yeah.
Or a cat is Rob's case.
In 10 years, I won't be able to do it, you know, so I might as well do it now.
Yeah. Now, what is all that stuff in back of you? Is that
John, but, you know, this is Hawaii, Mr. Bennett. You know, everything is messy because of the weather environment. You know, you got to have things in close to the house. You can't leave it out in the storage area. It's going to get all mildewy.
Yeah.
And we do a lot of stuff with plants and, you know, our dogs and stuff. And you work outdoors. You don't have a hobby room inside the house. It's too damn hot.
So how about air conditioning?
You know?
Yeah, but air conditioning.
I have air conditioning, but again, it's just too stifling, you know? So you got to work outdoors.
Renee, you should call us because we need somebody to call from the other side of the island.
Yeah.
She's in a nice area. Miss Renee's in a very fancy area over there.
Is she really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know she was in a fancy schmancy place.
It's a nice
area. View of the ocean. And
She has a view. And if you notice those sliding glass windows in her place, very nice.
And you're where? You're in the.
I'm out in the jungle here in Pepekeo on the Hamakua coast. This is, you know, this is all plantation country. In fact, our last plantation is closing, Mr. Meyer, on Maui, the Hawaii Sugar and Commercial Company run by the Alexander and Baldwin Corporation out of Honolulu.
That wasn't not Snickles.
Well, look who's here from her fancy schmancy mansion.
Hi, Miss Renee. How you doing?
Hello. How's it going?
On the money side of the island.
Yeah, we got a new mayor, too, Harry Kim. You know what?
There you go. No.
Now we're going to be calling her Our Money.
What?
Our Money. That's her rapper name.
That's my Our Money. Yeah, there you go. It's a nice view. Are you guys going to come over here sometime? Because I hear there's a really good Thai restaurant over there, and I was thinking about trying it.
Yeah, you might come out. I don't know.
We have a lot of places, yeah. But, you know, everything over here is real family-oriented. It's not atmosphere. You know what I'm talking about. It's a hole-in-a-wall type place, you know. For you guys, Mr. Bennett would think it'd be ramshackle out of, out of Mott Street.
You know, it looks like
Renee has a perfectly nice place.
Oh, yeah. Mr. Renee's got a very nice place.
How many bedrooms do you have, Renee?
It really isn't that big. It's only two.
Two bedrooms. That's fine.
Do you have someone from the university come over and take care of the housekeeping?
Of course not. I do my own housekeeping.
Okay. All right. Just wondering.
Correct.
So being out in the jungle, do you get like jungle rot on your feet and things like that?
Oh, man.
You can get probably your shoes outside. You got to shake them out constantly because, you know, you got bugs, centipedes, everything. Leather rot.
Oh, this is really a wonderful life you've cut out for
yourself.
Is
that a Spike Lee movie?
My shoes down here. I don't know if you can see it. My boots.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, the leather's already rotting out on top. But that's all right. I'll buy new steel toes.
And wait a minute. Let me get this straight. This is called paradise?
Yeah, paradise.
You said this is, did you say this was jungle fever?
Tropical pests, a survival handbook she just held
that's
up if
right.
You're watching the TV version.
Aren't those centipedes cute?
They're poisonous.
Yeah.
They can
be up to 12.
I'm just going to hurt.
Aren't there also millipedes?
Yeah, but the centipedes here, they'll get our dogs sick.
Really?
That's your control. Whack.
But they're not really over here. They're more over there.
Do you have snakes there?
No,
we snakes.
We have
cookie
frogs.
Yeah,
keep
no,
the snakes out
no
of the eye. We got
you know where else there are no snakes, Phil?
Ireland.
Huh?
Ireland.
No.
Harlem.
No. Lake Tahoe. Lake Tahoe.
Oh, no. That can't be true.
No, it is absolutely true. I know.
Yeah,
it's
got to be rattlesnakes there.
I spent my summers up there. Below, you go down a bit in altitude, and you have snakes, but there are no snakes in Lake Tahoe because snakes do not live up that high.
That's what, 8,000 feet?
Something like that. They don't live up there. Believe me, I know. I spent my summers there, you know.
You spent your summers in a bar at the Cal Neva. It was plenty of snakes at the Cal Neva.
There was a time when I couldn't get into the bars. Okay. And we spent and then we spent time in Reno. But no, you went down lower. Like I went to a camp on the way up to Lake Tahoe where I went to camp. Yeah. And I used to take a shower and there'd be a rattlesnake in the shower.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Cal Neva's on the north side anyway, not the south shore. Yeah. That's right.
Right.
Well, you know, the thing is, I am deathly afraid of snakes. I have a snake phobia like you wouldn't believe. And that's another reason for wanting to live in Hawaii, you know, to get away from snakes.
But you got to like the our bugs, Uncle.
Well, you know, in Maui on the south side, I never noticed that many. I lived in Miami. There's a breeze that runs through there all day, and that breeze just keeps the mosquitoes away. The thing is, when I lived in Miami, they had these things called palmetto bugs.
Oh, they're wonderful. Yeah. All those things.
And they were just the biggest, ugliest
things.
Well,
they're roaches that fly.
That's right.
They're big roaches that fly. Do you have them down there, Rob, where you are?
No, I lived in Florida, too. I had my introduction to palmetto bugs. Yeah. Scared the living bejesus out of me.
I was sitting in a movie theater watching a movie, and a palmetto bug came up on my lap.
It was looking for a better view?
I gave it some popcorn. It went away.
Yeah.
You know, there was something else in Florida that you had to contend with, which was called love bugs.
Yes.
And there were these little bugs that would not only get into your radiator and your ventilation system, they'd wind up coming through the air conditioning vents.
Yeah.
By the way, I'm glad you said radiator because that's what it's called.
What's he got there?
These are some of the giant snails we got over here.
Move it closer to your camera.
About yay big.
That's a snail.
That's a snail.
That's escargot.
No, escargot.
They'll eat your payas. They'll eat your avocados. They'll take everything.
Wow.
They can be up to probably 3.5 inches.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. They're big biggies. Yeah.
See, there's a good reason for TV tonight. By the way, folks, I'm scratching my nose, it's because it's itching tonight.
Yeah, what do you do? Put salt on those guys?
I just bag them up and then take them to the dump. You know, we don't have garbage pickup. I got to go to the dump every Sunday and Tuesdays.
Such work.
How many of those are there in your? You have to literally shovel them up.
I got a whole garbage can full in here, right in here. I don't know if you see down in there.
Yeah.
But I go to the dump. You know, I load my truck because we don't have garbage pickup here.
No, we don't have garbage here either.
Oh, Auntie, is your dump in Kona? Are you open on Saturdays there?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, good.
So you don't compost all your stuff and.
What do you do with the wood and all the other and all the other crap you got? You know, certain you can. But wet garbage, you know, you're going to attract bugs and wild pigs.
Well, if I move there to kill these roaches and these bugs and these centipedes, I'd buy myself a ukulele because then when I smash them with the ukulele, I'd kill two birds with one stone.
Let me ask you something.
I'd be killing the bug and I'd be getting rid of the ukulele.
So if there's no garbage service, there's no entrepreneur in your area with a truck that says, I'll pick your stuff up for X amount of dollars and he takes it down there himself?
Yeah, we have some folks who do that, but the problem is, you know, they're very loco, and Uncle, when I feel like it.
Oh, they're on Hawaii time.
Exactly. Yeah. Maybe he might come once a week, but you'll never know when he shows up.
Sunday morning, right underneath your bedroom window. Thank you.
Hey, I get that all week long. From the condo across the street.
So far tonight, we've had a kitty on the show.
Snail
and some dogs. What?
I want to see the new kitty.
If I get disconnected, it's because this little kitten is chewing on wires. track of them.
Can you grab your new kitty?
He's behind some equipment.
When you see him, grab him so she can.
Yeah, you'll have fun in Hawaii.
Look at the kitty.
Yeah.
Phil, there's one more thing you said that you're not getting, that you're a little wrong on. The mosquitoes. These buddies, and I grew up in the South. I mean, not deep South. I grew up where Rob is, or close to it, not exactly. But mosquitoes there, you can usually, when there's a nice wind that comes by, it usually takes care of those mosquitoes. That's not how they are here.
Right. I was talking about South Maui, you know, where you get that nice trade wind in the afternoon.
It's funny because the mosquitoes, it'll be breezy. The mosquitoes will land on you and still start eating. And you're like, seriously, this is a decent wind.
Right on your eyeglasses, everything.
Yeah. And they eat, they I've never seen.
New York is beginning to sound pretty damn good to me because all we have here are rats.
Well, we got rats too.
You got mosquitoes. You got all sorts of stuff in New York.
It's supposed to be spreading with the Zika virus, I heard.
There's a kitty.
We have a hepatitis. I've had my hepatitis shot already. Because we've got over 220 cases of Hep A. So, you know, it was the scallops, Auntie.
At the restaurant?
In Honolulu.
Sushi place?
Yeah, Genki Sushi in Honolulu. But unfortunately, two of the Hawaiian Air stewardesses got ill, and they're the ones that fly into Hilo and Kona. Yeah.
Not good.
By the way, does anybody else want to call up tonight with some show and tell? Hello, Tony. Do you have anything to show us?
Actually, not offhand.
Well, in case you didn't hear earlier this week, we let Tony back on.
Oh, thank you. And thank you very much for keeping.
Yeah.
And thank you very much for letting Tony back on.
That was a mitzvah.
My girlfriend said to me, "Why did you let Tony back on?" She said, "I may stop listening."
I don't blame her.
And I said, "Because I was getting too much shit from my callers. Well, you let Tony on. He's really a good guy. He's okay."
I got things under control right now. She's on the couch sleeping.
Who?
Okay. I know you don't want to hear about it. I heard you talking to Shotzi, so I figured you might.
Well, how many dogs do you have, James? Five or six?
I have five right now. You can see Patches right there.
Oh, he's cute.
Yep, and then there's Kissy.
Looks like a bulldog.
You know, Kissy's a 14-year-old pug, Kissy. And then here's Shadow.
Wait a minute. Let me make the picture bigger for our audience. There we
Shadow.
Go. There's
see
Shadow. Show the other two dogs that you just showed
Kissy,
so people can see them.
Kissy's getting quite elderly. She's almost 14.
Yeah.
Wow, that's pretty old. Good puppy.
Yeah. And then let's see. Patches. Where did Patches? Oh, here's Patches over here. Patchy.
There you go.
She's a different kind of dog.
Somebody has their summer cut. I see.
There's some. Nice. Five. I would love to have five.
Yeah. Yeah, I got five. And then let's see. Oh, Rosie's over here. Rosie snoozing on the chair.
And they all get along nice.
It's Rosie.
She's like, I got my spot. I'm good.
She said, leave me alone, dude. Rosie says, leave me alone. And Raven, I don't know, Raven is chasing a cookie frog somewhere. Oh, there's Raven over here.
By the way, I like green and white colors on the house.
It's nice.
Yeah, really pretty.
Does that bug zapper thing work? That electric
It does help. I keep it on 24/7 because otherwise it'd be flying all over as I'm talking to you. It does keep it down. In fact, I have to clean out that filter every 2 weeks. You can see it's already filled with a bunch of bugs and cobwebs.
Is that from QVC?
Yeah, it's QVC. Yeah.
I bought one too.
They're good. They're good. They're about 60, 70 bucks, but they're well worth it. Yes.
Yeah.
They don't use that much juice and they zap them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's over, you know, like I said, jungle over here.
Look at that. I mean, my God.
It's got a nice garden.
That's your backyard?
It's about, you know, it's about 50 yards down to the water line over there because the river abuts my property over there. So our dogs can run all over the place over there.
Wow.
Let's see. Well, we're just a jungle shack, you know, that's all it is.
Very pretty.
Yeah, over there you can see the avocado tree with the pink blossoms.
Yeah.
I don't know. And the avocado's hanging.
Oh, yeah.
See how they're hanging there. You may not see it on my little camera here.
It's 12 grams of carbohydrate in each one of those.
I was just going to say.
Yeah,
but see, you guys don't understand. I haven't seen it yet because when I got here, they were just going out of season. But okay. I'm going to go buy a regular California avocado, and then I will also buy a Hawaiian avocado when I can find them, and they're literally the size of a cantaloupe.
Wow.
Almost the size of a cantaloupe.
From
California.
Aren't there roadside fruit stands and things?
There's roadside fruit stands, and then you know you can go to Lowe's or Home Depot and get these plants also.
They're not supposed to be here.
You know. Anyway.
Oh, but you mean avocados aren't native to Hawaii?
No.
They're from Queens.
Oh.
Queens. Now, are there any native fruits there that you can pick?
I would eat papaya in Hawaii.
Well, besides papayas, you know, obviously. Yeah. The only problem with papaya are mangoes. You know, you eat too many of that, you get the real runs, too. You can't.
What I understood when I was in Hawaii years ago is that if you went and stole some pineapple,
that could be a
big offense.
Really? Yeah, because
when you were in Hawaii.
Wait a minute. Let me listen to what James has to say. What were you saying, James?
The canneries, Hawaiian Sugar and Commercial run by Alexander and Baldwin, you know, they're the big movers over here. And you don't screw with that corporation. What they say is law. And it even still is today because of their control with the politicians over here. You know, because everyone's related to the plantations. You know, Mr. Meyer, the last plantation is going to close in Maui this year. They're going to put 600 people out of work. And those plantation jobs are $24 an hour. There are no jobs on Maui that pay $24 an hour, I tell you right now.
Wow.
Yeah,
I was just going to say earlier that when Alex was in Hawaii, King Kamehameha was in charge.
Who's King Kamehameha?
it's probably what's his name? Frank Fozzi, the Italian.
No, King Kamehameha was the...
The king of Hawaii when I was there was Don Ho.
Yeah, too bad he died an alcoholic, unfortunately.
Did he die an alcoholic? Really?
Yeah. They're fighting over his estate right now.
But he's been dead for 20 years, hasn't he?
Yeah. But, you know, he had a lot of trust set up as usual. And, you know how Hawaiians, we have these extended families, cousins and uncles and, you know, kids that come out of the woodwork. Because, you know, no one adopts here in Hawaii. You know, if someone becomes pregnant and, you know, because of our Church of the Latter-day Saints and the Catholic Church, everyone is, we take care of our own.
Right.
Even though that may be a half brother or a half sister, but then they're sent off to one of the other islands while the daughter goes on to Harvard and becomes a lawyer and marries on the mainland. No one says that she's got another half child somewhere else. Only at a family gathering, they'll be introduced as cousin so-and-so.
Oh, wow.
That is Hawaii. In fact, you have it right now with our congressperson, you know, Ms. Renee Tulsi Gabbard, Congresswoman Gabbard in the House of Representatives. If you look at her, she's dark complexion. You look at her dad, he's an Irishman, Gabbard. If you look at her mother, she's a very fair English woman. And yet you never see Tulsi standing with her parents, never.
Wow.
You know, no one says. Nobody says. You know, it's interesting. She grew up on another island, and yet she's become a congresswoman. And her father is on the Honolulu like board of supervisors. And all he says is, "Yes, I have a daughter," and that's it. But this is Hawaii.
Don Ho was that rich that they're fighting over all that money.
Yeah, wow. You know, sure. It had to do with his music, I believe. He had a lot of debts. You know, he had a drinking problem. We all know that.
Tiny Bubbles?
I didn't know he had a drinking problem.
And, you know, a lot of women, a whole bit. You know,
did he write Tiny Bubbles?
That was one of his songs, correct.
That was the big hit for him.
But you got to be careful, you know, Ms. Renee. You don't want to say too much about Don Ho because the folks here, they don't look too nicely about him. Let's put it that way.
They don't like him.
But, you know, they think he sold out.
How did he sell out any more than the rest of Hawaii sells out 24/7?
So the issue is that he used to, when you said he's that rich, he used to do a show. He had a long standing show at the Hilton Hawaiian Village five nights a week for like 20 some odd years. That man must have some money.
Remember his organ? He'd bring that organ up.
So he was like David Letterman for for the Islands for a very long, or the Johnny Carson for the Islands.
He had a TV show then, or no, out there?
You know, they don't think he's authentic, you know, and you know, he's not the native Hawaiian, you know, and that's the other, that was the other issue.
Well, who is authentic?
Well, that's another question, too.
See, but that's not really fair, because these people can actually trace their heritage back to the island. It's not like, oh, yeah.
There was a time in the United States, and folks, this was a horrible time, when America fell in love with Hawaiian music.
That's right.
And there were a lot of bands like Harry Owens and his Royal Hawaiians.
In New York City, you had a show in New York City from Hawaii.
Really?
20 years ago. I forget. It was one of your nightclubs.
But, you know, they used to, Hawaii was like a big deal.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, and Hawaiian music, I always hated it. I couldn't stand it. You know, I wound up at a hotel in Hawaii, and I wound up in a hotel room, and one afternoon, they used to, during the afternoon, they would have parties out by the pool and everything. Right under my window, they had a Hawaiian band playing. I wanted to commit suicide.
Yeah. But you got free music, though.
No, I always said that that was an oxymoron. Hawaiian music.
I love Hawaiian music.
You love Hawaiian music.
I knew his
You like acapella.
Well, you know.
I always thought of Elvis with Hawaiian. He was
like, you know, Israel, of course, was, you know, the 600-pound guy. I can never pronounce his last name, but you know, his voice and the his songs were beautiful. But you know, I like just standard Hawaiian music. You know, ukulele. You know, with
ukulele is not Hawaiian. Ukulele is from Portugal.
Really?
Yeah. Well,
Portugal's Hawaii too, Auntie. Come on, you know.
I love the sound of Hawaiian music. I mean, to me, it's relaxing, and it brings pleasant thoughts.
Hmm. Well, I saw your island today, the back half of your island, because I was way up at the end.
Ah.
Oh, were you up on the north side?
And here's you the silver sea. Oh. Hello, ladies.
You go fuck yourself.
Tiny bubbles. Tiny bubbles.
And the wine.
Okay, there's reason number one to hate Hawaiian music.
No, you have to admit, tiny.
I don't like that.
Marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
What?
We've got the best cash crop, marijuana, you know, and here on our big island of Hawaii. We've got over 6,000 legal marijuana users with the medical card, and we've already got two licensed dispensaries that are going to be opening.
Yeah, but you only got 5,000 residents.
Yeah, but 6,000 of them all got the card.
Yeah. And see, you think that's funny? He's only, what, 60 miles or maybe even 80 miles away? And his side of the island, they're all... They're not really up for here. They're break down. It's a big picture of the island, and it's like fog.
I don't go for that marijuana stuff.
In fact, I can smell the aroma right now. It's about
Hawaii looks nice.
It's about 5 o'clock, so everybody's having a smoke right outside right now. It's Friday. You have your beer and everything.
Israel.
I like this.
Yeah,
that's a good song. Yeah.
Well, the fat fuck dropped dead.
Well, he knew that was going to happen.
You knew it was going to happen. You looked at
him. He did, too. You know, he sort of planned for that eventuality.
But that's the only thing he's known for, really.
No, he's got a number of other songs that are...
Name one. Not right now. Name one.
You know, I listened to his album. It's one of the CDs I have at the store.
I just got a note from Skype that says you've got a lot of background noise. No, that's Hawaiian music.
That's my dog, sorry.
Nice.
Yeah.
Anyway, folks, I'm going to back out. I got to take care of my dogs and do some more yard work before the end of the day.
Well,
so.
You have to find
James, I have a question. What you said you got a graduate degree. What was your degree in?
My degree was in environmental health, sanitary science, and healthcare administration.
Ah, okay.
He was a garbage man.
Yeah, garbage man, exactly. Yeah, I healthy got garbage. Money to look at people's shit. You know what I mean? I got, you know,
cemetery
a lot of bucks
science. That was a nice way of putting it, huh?
He was a healthy garbage guy.
Because we also did the drug labs too. That was the only part that was, we went in ahead of everybody else, so we had to be careful.
Thanks, James. We really appreciate.
Okay, thank
the
you,
call.
Folks. Aloha and take care. And we'll see you, folks. Yeah. Okay.
Mahalo for not smoking. Anyway, that's
so
James Lee.
The sun is just going down over there, and he's outside, so it's prime mosquito time. And that's probably why you wanted to finish up so quickly and get in.
Yeah.
It has those bug zappers.
Oh, they really come out big.
Yeah. Some of these guys, and you get to know there's like 8 of them that hang around, and you get to know which one it is because it actually will land on you and start, like, what the? You know, so it at night, it's in the evening or in the morning, it's far worse in the evening.
Now, last week on the show at this time, we had almost 10 people.
Yeah.
Where are they tonight?
It's football.
It's shops.
I know. I got a note from Patrick who says I can't do it. I can't come on tonight. Maybe I'll try during a break.
Season football, no less.
Huh?
It doesn't even count. It's preseason.
It's preseason. Yeah.
Air Supply will be playing in Kona.
Who?
Air Supply.
Do people still go to Air Supply concerts?
No, I would never go to an Air Supply concert.
I hosted one once.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Sorry.
I use an Air Supply every time I go diving.
There you go.
Did
you get any new equipment?
Yeah, I've had to have my BC enlarged, the cummerbund and strap, so that I could buckle it up.
Listen,
over
you fat drugs. Fuck, when are you going to lose some weight?
Hey, I'm working on it.
No, I can't afford. Look how few people are calling tonight. If you were dead, I'd have 3.
That's terrible.
Is that your way of saying being nice, Alex?
All I'm saying is if I can do it, you can do it.
Yeah, I know. Hey, I was thinking about it today.
Oh, well, that's good. I'm glad you're thinking about
it. Hey, I had eggs and bacon this morning. Ooh. This afternoon I had chicken a half a chicken breast.
Mm-hmm.
And
the whole chicken breast, by the way. You could eat the whole chicken.
Well, I went to this place and they only serve you the half. So, it was good.
You can eat the skin. Skin's fine.
Yeah, I had it. And but I came home tonight and I had a little pad thai.
See, there's your problem.
Pad thai.
Now, however good you were today, you blew it all by doing that because you upset the balance.
I am jonesing for pad thai. You know, I've had to learn that there's northern and southern pad thai food.
Okay, I got to tell you, I have not been jonesing for much of anything on this diet. Okay. I perhaps once I've gotten to where I want to be, I might one night have some pasta, just treat myself, okay? Because I do miss pasta. But tonight I was watching MasterChef. You ever watch MasterChef?
I like that cooking show.
Yeah. And I'm watching Gordon Ramsay. And tonight, it was a very good show because what they did was they started out, they had to make French fries. Perfect French fries. And you would think that's easy, right? You take some.
What is a perfect French fry?
Yeah.
Well, you got to cut the potato evenly. Okay. Usually, see, they had to do it with a knife.
Use a press?
Usually people use a press, right?
Right.
You know. And then you had to, put them in get the oil hot enough and then put them in and get it so they get a nice little light brown on the outside and they're cooked all the way through.
Mm-hmm.
That's the hard part, cooking them all the way through and getting them just brown enough on top. And so I'm watching this and I'm going, French fries.
They'll go with ketchup.
So, as if that isn't enough, they get rid of 4 people. They don't lose. They actually win and don't have to go on to the next test. The next test is mashed potatoes. And there they are with the cream and the butter and the potatoes. And they're mixing
together. I told you use cauliflower.
Yeah, those would make really good mashed potatoes.
Forget it.
Yes.
That's not the point of what I'm saying, Phil.
I know.
I'm watching this TV show, and now I'm going, mashed potatoes.
Right.
You know, I just can't watch that show. And then when I was leaving, they were making, like, I don't know, a little, you know, another kind of thing where you take the potato and I guess you make it into mashed potatoes and then you fry it, you know, what are they, croquettes or whatever.
And croquettes.
And I'm going, you know, I can't watch this show on my diet because they're cooking stuff and I'm going, yummy.
Well, who's that chef? Is Mario Vitale or something?
Yeah, well, yeah, the guy that doesn't wear shoes, he wears Crocs. He's the last person in America wearing Crocs.
Well, he'll, you know, he's got an audience in front of him, a studio audience, mm-hmm. and he picks up a salt shaker and he says, "Now I'm going to salt," and the whole audience gives him applause. With salt, and he says, "I'm going to put a little paprika." Boom, and they're applauding. And you ever noticed that?
Each condiment, he makes another $1 million. So
is that the other guy?
Emeril Lagasse.
Oh,
that's it. It's not Mario. Emeril Lagasse.
Lagasse never was as smart a businessman as Mario Batali. He and this other guy who used to be on MasterChef, I'm trying to remember his name now, they own a restaurant we love going to here called Bapo's.
Yeah.
And it's wonderful. But they own something else that is, at least while I'm dieting, the worst place I can walk into. And it's called Italy.
Oh, yeah, it's the pasta
last
place.
Last year, Italy made $72 million profit.
Oof. Wow. Wow.
It is on the corner of 23rd Street and 5th Avenue.
Just one store.
It's a little bigger than a store. You couldn't. Okay. It's the size of the floor of, say, a department store. I mean, it's a department store for food, and they've got.
That's the way that DDL food show used to be in New York.
They got
De Laurentiis.
Huh.
There used to be a place, Dino De Laurentiis, DDL food show, and it was this big restaurant, and you could get pasta, you could get deli stuff. It was phenomenal. You don't remember it? It was probably you were probably in San Francisco.
I don't remember, but I got to say, it was just. I mean, Italy is to die for, and they then built one in Chicago that's doing very well. And it's doing so well in Manhattan, they're opening up another one further downtown. Lydia, what's her name?
That's the Italian chef who won the watches, though, Lydia.
Yeah, well, her son and her are also part of the owners of
Italy. I didn't know. Okay. Yeah. I know he's, okay.
Yeah. DDL Food Show opened in May of 83.
Yeah, well, anyway, Batali really knows his business. You know, and has made a fortune off of it. You know, I wonder if we could look at this as these chefs are killing America.
No, that was what's her name?
Yeah. I know you're.
Oh, they've got pictures of Italy. Amazing food market. Wow. I'm looking at the breads. Mm-hmm. Unbelievable.
Wait, I would go there and get fresh ravioli. That's how I got up to
Italy's with an E.
240 pounds, eating that ravioli.
Okay, so you guys are having a food fest here at night. That's only going to lead to bad things.
No, it's not going to lead to bad things because I have something else that I can rely on, and that's the memory that I used to weigh 40 pounds more.
Okay, good.
And then I went to all this trouble to lose the 40 pounds, and there's no way I'm putting it back on.
Good. That's great.
I mean, that's why. I mean, you've had trouble with diets too, right, Rob?
Always.
I mean, your whole life?
Yeah.
For the greater part of it, I've kept it under control, but now I'm on this pill, and I can't lose a frickin' pound. So until I get off this damn...
What is it? It's an antidepressant or something, right?
Yeah.
Why can't you lose weight while you're on that pill?
I don't know. No idea.
I mean, there are some antidepressants which do have a tendency to put poundage on you.
Yeah.
He's on one of those. But I didn't have much luck with the one I was on that we had talked about, so I switched to another one, and I'm hoping that'll be better.
Sucks, because no matter what you do,
It's going to stay on you unless you get
off that couple. But you just you plateau real quick, and that's it.
Well, you know, I mean, what you got to do, one of the good things about the Atkins thing.
Yeah, I was on it.
Yeah, is that the results are fast.
Mm-hmm.
The initial results are fast. And that gives you the encouragement to keep going.
Yeah.
You know?
And I was in ketosis. I checked the strips and everything like that. My body's in ketosis. I'm not losing weight.
You got to stick with it. You just got to stick with it.
Insulin resistance.
Like, I mean, I hit a plateau a couple of weeks ago, and I hit that plateau for a couple of weeks. And that's the time when you see, for the first 20 pounds, I didn't have a scale here.
Oh, wow.
Because I didn't want to get on a scale every day and let that either depress me or make me feel good. And so girlfriend then went out and bought, you know, a real regulation slidey thing scale.
Yeah.
Doctor's scale.
Nice.
And now every day I weigh myself three times. Every time I take a pee and every time I take a shit.
Really?
Yes. I can lose a pound by taking a good dump and peeing three times.
Okay? Oh, get it.
I can lose a pound.
That's gray matter.
Well, and if I do it naked, it's a half a pound less.
Yeah. I thought you were only supposed to weigh yourself once a day at the same time of
the day. I do, but it's
he's got that scale. He wants his money's worth.
But if I didn't have that scale, I wouldn't know how much I weighed right now, and I still would be losing because I would be on the diet. I would just feel it, you know. And people say, well, how do you know you're losing weight? I said, my pants are falling off. That's how I know I'm losing weight. You know,
I used to eat out of boredom, really, sometimes.
You eat out, well, a lot of people eat out of boredom.
I'll be watching a game or something and then just grab it, something, I just get bored. It's like, you know.
Renee, do you eat when you're sad? Girls have a tendency to eat when they're sad.
Yeah, but lately, because I'm changing off of medications, I'm not sleeping at night. And when you don't sleep at night, that's when you start eating. So, or that's when I start eating. So then you get a whole bunch of calories in you and you go back to sleep. So I'm trying I had to change up some meds that I was on, and hopefully that'll help me.
Well, we eat dinner, it's about 6 o'clock every night. Really, you shouldn't eat past around 7 at night, you know? And somebody once said that if you sleep less hours, like if you're an 8-hour sleeper like I am and you only sleep 6 instead, you will lose weight because you're spending more time moving around.
How do you sleep for 8 hours? I cannot do that anymore.
I take a Xanax.
When I wasn't using the CPAP machine, I could sleep all the time, 24/7. But now I go to bed at 10. I'm up at 5:36, and I feel great.
Well, girlfriend has trouble going to sleep, so she takes a Xanax,
mm-hmm.
two Benadryl. 250 milligram Benadryl.
Oh, 100 Benadryl.
Yeah, and a couple other things,
you don't need that.
Is that every night?
Yes.
And all at once?
Yeah.
Oh, my Lord.
Yeah, but here's the funny part about it. Because otherwise she can't go to sleep, and she goes to sleep at 9:30, and she gets up at 4 o'clock in the morning, okay?
Yeah, but she's falling asleep when she's sitting on GABNet.
Let me finish this. Oh, no, she's only one night a week is she up past 9:30. Okay. And that's when she does my show.
Yeah.
But she'll want to watch a TV show. We put a TV show on. Next thing I know, I look over. She's asleep.
Mm.
And I wake her up, and then we, you know, had dinner. And then we put on another TV show. She's falling asleep. Now
you know,
it's 9:30. She can't get to sleep.
You know the quickest way to fall asleep?
Yeah.
Listen to a rerun of your show.
let me write this down because I may have to use that joke sometime because it's so good.
Yeah. Glad you appreciate it. And
so
I won't even charge you for it.
Say football games tonight?
Yeah.
Yeah. RG3.
I don't know.
Oh, fuck football.
Going to a football.
Patrick, it has to be Green Bay, and I think it's Green Bay and the 49ers.
Yeah.
Tony, you'll know how many football games, how many football nights this season?
Oh, that I don't know offhand. I know this.
17.
No. I mean, how many weeks? I mean, how many nights a week are they playing? They keep expanding it.
Oh, I know these are what they play Thursday nights.
Thursday.
Thursday
Sunday.
Nights. Sunday and Monday. Are they going to do a Wednesday? I don't think they are.
I don't know. That's, I swear, I thought you knew because you're. I'm not a football guy.
Tony, I think it's just Thursday. I don't even like the Thursday. I don't know how they're getting away with that, really.
Tony?
It's stunning, really.
Where were you just before you got over to the GABNet show? Where were you?
Yeah. Oh, I was at the Mecca with my brother.
Okay.
I left in the sixth inning because I left the Mets. I'm going home, Mets, because I go home to walk the dog.
I know.
Well, Mets Stadium is pretty close to you.
Yeah, I was home pretty quick, really. I was home maybe a half hour.
Was there a subway?
Go to both of those.
Is there a subway that goes from?
Yeah, I took seven home back to Woodside, and I just jumped on the bus. So I was home in about 35 minutes.
Oh.
That's not it.
Well, that's cool.
It's pretty good, yeah. Actually, it's a nice – I like Citi Field, even though I'm a Yankee fan. I'm liking the Citi Field. I like how it's set up. It's convenient, like you said. It's so easy to get there.
By the way, I just saw that Jeff Stein signed his Skype on, so maybe he'll call us.
Yeah.
And we'll get a little additional oomph.
You guys may agree. I like fish and
What'd you say, Renee? Renee just.
I said, you guys have made me hungry. I want fish and chips now.
Well, that'd be great.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well,
but Alex can't have the chips.
See, you know what my vice is? I can't drink fish
either because it's coated.
Yeah.
Really?
Like tomorrow, I'm going to go out to Shecky's and we're going to go have lunch together. And we usually like to go to the sushi place.
Oh, yeah. You said you like
I
the sushi.
I can't do that anymore.
Well, have the sashimi.
Because it cost me. It's a flat fee, but it's like $25 a piece.
Wow. Yeah.
And I won't get my money's worth out there.
If you have sashimi.
I could eat. I can have some sashimi, but what I'm saying is there's a lot of other stuff out there too, like sushi and desserts and all kinds of stuff. And most of the stuff are in sauces, so I can't eat it.
Yeah. You gotta watch it a little
bit. So we're gonna go get ribs.
There you go.
Oh, yeah, ribs. He's gonna love his ribs. I know he loves.
You can eat places. You got to stay clear of them. You know, I went to this in Florida. I went to Joe's Stone Crab, and they said all you can eat stone crab.
Yeah, I've been there. I can't eat stone crab. You know why?
Why?
Because the juice from the stone crab, I'm allergic to. It's
really?
My fingers start itching. Yeah, I used to go to Jones. I hate Joe's Stone Crab. Let me explain this to people. Are you familiar with the stone crab?
Yeah.
And what do they serve at Joe's Stone Crab place? What
stone crab?
What part of the crab?
The claw.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you know how they get that claw?
Yeah, they rip them off.
Yeah.
And they grow back, right?
They rip off one claw and then throw the thing back in the water.
Yeah.
Leave the other one on so it can pick its nose.
Yeah, well, no. And then the claw grows back.
Yeah.
Right.
Wow, and then they fish for it again and they rip it off again.
Right.
Yeah. Now, okay. I'm thinking I'm the crab, okay? I'm swimming around. I'm eating whatever crabs eat in the water, you know. It's wonderful under there, you know. I'm singing songs like Under the Sea to myself, and I'm having a really nice time. And all of a sudden, I get ensnared in this net, and I get lifted out of the sea. And while I'm looking around, some guy comes along and rips my claw off. And then throws me back in the water. Now, knowing me, I'm a pretty depressed crab. Because
you cannot attribute, human traits.
Let me finish my story. Right. Let me do my bit here, Phil.
I do your bit
without interrupting me doing a bit.
All right.
Okay. So I'm I have no claw. And then all of a sudden, one day, I kind of wake up and then, hey, it's starting to come back. And finally, I've got my claw back. What, I'm in a net again? Oh, no, fuck. Now, I think that's crueler than anything they do to animals and killing them and everything, is to rip the claw off a poor crab.
What is it called when you attribute human characteristics to animals?
The term is... Transference. Huh?
Transference.
There is a term. It's what I didn't like about Disney, that he would make animals into people, you know.
Yeah, and you can't attribute those things to crabs.
This is what I just said to you. I'm not saying in all seriousness, but I still think it's cruel to rip a claw off a crab.
He's so good.
It's a guy's view. You're just upset because he's ripping the right claw, the right-handed claw off, and
you don't
doesn't matter
for the left.
If he's right-handed, you just ruined it.
know, see? So
yeah, take a left. Yeah. I don't do nothing.
Yeah.
He can't wipe himself.
I don't think they have a rule about you have to take the right claw or the left claw. They just take the one that looks better.
Yeah, for the bigger claw.
But then they throw him back in, the claw grows now, back. This crab's gone now, his whole I went, life having his goddamn claws ripped off.
I went to a stone crab place in the Keys. And, you know, they have all sorts of different sizes of stone crab. You can get jumbo, extra jumbo, real extra jumbo. And some of these ones are really big, and they're really good. Yeah. It's,
now, is that healthy? The crab
they have to be shot at something. There's no way that's natural.
No. It's, you know, they just divide up. You got a bucket of the super jumbos and a bucket of the regulars, and you get a pound's worth, and, you know, they...
They give you a little hammer.
They actually crack them for you.
Maybe they give you a hammer.
Yeah.
Well, this place, they crack them with
a... At Joe's, they give you a hammer.
Yeah.
And they give you, like, some butcher paper and stuff to do it on.
I don't remember what they gave me at Joe's. All I remember is the waiter said, "We're not going to make any money on you." So I said, "Keep coming." I must have had 20 pieces.
There used to be a place out in Texas near Houston. It's the San Jacinto Monument, and I can't remember what the name of the place was. But what it was all you could eat shrimp.
Yeah.
Followed by, it was right on the Gulf, all you can eat shrimp, followed by chicken. I fried chicken. Okay? So they would bring you a bunch of the shrimp. Now you had to peel the shrimp. That was how they made it. They figured you weren't going to eat that fast. Okay? So you had to peel the shrimp. But we went down there and dipped it in sauce. I must have eaten 40, 50 shrimp. I mean, it was just all-you-can-eat shrimp.
So you did.
And then they bring you the chicken, and it's just this fucked-up piece of fried chicken that nobody wants to eat because they're so full from having eaten the shrimp. And
do you ever have crawdads?
I'm wondering if that place is still there.
Do you ever have crawdads?
No. Hold on a second. Renee is giving us the vomit look.
That's because that's why do people eat those things?
Go ahead.
Eat a crawdad.
How's that so different from eating a lobster?
You gotta pinch the crawdad in such a way, and then you twist the thing and you pull it.
Oh, you're talking about the little ones?
Yeah.
Oh, those aren't really. Crawdaddies are bigger than that. That's what you're talking about. Crawdads.
They're from Louisiana.
Yeah, but I don't know if they're called crawdads. I think they're called something else.
Crawdads or crayfish.
Crayfish. That's it. Yeah.
Okay. Same thing. It just depends on where in the fucking East Coast you've been, but they're little teeny lobster-looking critters. Right.
You can have it cooked into like stews and things like that, and they're really good because they do the shelling for you and bring the meat out and so on. Well, here comes an expert, right?
That would be really good.
Amy Manuel has got to be an expert. Hello, Amy.
Shelling crawfish.
Hi, sorry.
Yeah.
talking about crawfish. You're talking about Cajun food. My husband's Cajun, yes. Although he doesn't eat crawfish because he has an allergy.
How do you get the meat out of the shell?
Oh, well, first of all, what they're called. Yeah. And so there are lots of names and they all refer to the same thing.
Okay.
So a crawfish, a crayfish, a mud bug, a crawdaddy, a crawdad. I know there's at least 20 other names, but it's all the same thing.
By the way, we've been joined by Patrick.
Hey, Patrick.
Been joined by Patrick. Hello, Patrick. Is the game over yet?
No, it's halftime.
It's halftime.
It's halftime. Oh, okay.
I got 15 minutes.
All of a sudden, my numbers went up. I figured it's because it's halftime. Anyway, no, but let's get back to Amy. We don't have a picture on you, Amy, but that's okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So explain
crawfish, crawdads, crayfish, mud bugs. There's a whole list of names. It's all the same thing.
Is a lagostino the same thing?
No, that's a lobster.
That's a lobster. No, crawfish generally are about 3 to... really big one would be like 6 inches long. But once you take off the head, you're only talking maybe 4 inches.
And then people,
and they're only about an inch wide.
It's the same way with guys. Once you take off the head, it's only
there's such a waste of time.
And what you do is you twist off the head, and if you're a true Cajun, then you suck the juice out of the head, because that's where all the seasoning is stored.
That's one of the
southern pickup lines you've ever heard.
And
baby, and then do me like a crawdaddy.
So the hard part of the shell is toward the palm of your hand, and with your thumbs, you're gonna push down in the soft part and pull, and that'll open up the shell.
Pull
out the shell. This pulls me out.
It's only about this big.
By the way, Patrick probably only has a short time before he has to get back to the game, right, Patrick?
Yeah, but this is entertaining. I always like to hear about sucking head, you know, and different techniques different people have. I mean, I'm good with that.
I just don't like the part about ripping off the head.
Well, I mean, you know, praying mantis, the female bite the head off before sex.
Hey, my ex-wife used to do that.
Yeah. wait a minute, Amy. Now, for instance, they do take crawfish and they put it in other things like jambalaya and stuff like that. Am I right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It does go in just about anything that you would put shrimp or crab in.
Right.
You can get crawfish in. In fact, during crawfish season, there was a little fast food Chinese restaurant that made crawfish fried rice. And I remember I was working at Lamar at the student employment office, and we ordered from this place, and the secretary got some sort of shrimp thing, and I got crawfish fried rice. And she said, "Well, your shrimp tastes better than my shrimp." And I said, "That's because they're not shrimp."
Ah, Rob?
Does anybody remember the name of that show that Joe Rogan hosted on NBC that was like in the early prime evening, where they would dare people to do things? Does anybody remember that show?
Fear Factor.
Yeah.
So I just, because I don't know from crawdaddies or any of that stuff, and I'm Googling it, and I came up with this, and to me it looks like just like
let
with
me, let me bring your, force your picture
people.
So yeah, it's disgusting.
It looks like you have to eat this, and everybody would go, ugh. You know,
they are so good.
Oh, they're delicious.
You have to peel that.
What's better, like what my husband would eat if he went to a crawfish boil, they put new potatoes, small potatoes, and little half ears of corn and onions in with the crawfish and the crawfish boil in the big pot. And those soak up the seasoning even better than the crawfish do. So those are really, really good and spicy.
When I went to a crawfish feed, they had them on a picnic table, and they had butcher paper on the picnic table, and the whole table was covered with these crawfish, and you just broke them apart, ate them, and throw the shells in a bowl.
Patrick, and that was Patrick has his hand up. Patrick.
We have a restaurant very near my place. It's called Crawdaddy's.
Yeah.
And all they do is get crawfish boiled And it's great. It's good eat. I mean, they have other types of seafood as well, but they specialize in importing crawfish. So
I've got some good stories about crawfish, but I'm going to have to let y'all go because I got stuff to do.
Okay. We'll see you later, Amy. Thank you.
Talk to you later.
I knew she would probably call because she's the expert, but then something was happening to her audio anyway. So good riddance to bad audio.
Yes. Patrick. If you want your own, just go down to your local creek and start picking them out of the creek.
Okay.
That's where they hang.
Okay.
In the mud.
Okay. As long as we're talking food tonight, and that's good for me. Let me tell you something that we have started to eat here. One day, I have always liked hot dogs with the skin on them.
Agreed.
Okay.
Agreed.
Not the fucking whatever the casing is they use for the skinless. You know how many? I don't know how a hot dog can be skinless unless it's molded.
It pops when you have the skin and you bite into it.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Exactly. Yeah.
So I found this skinned thing because they used to have the skinned Nathan's
skinned
hot dogs, and they don't have them anywhere here.
What about Sabret's?
Yes.
May I finish what I'm saying? You always interrupt before I'm finished with what I'm saying.
All right. Well, we great minds think alike.
No, but what I'm saying is that I had a hard time finding the Nathan's anymore, the skin version with skin. Right. So, but Boar's Head has a hot dog with skin. It's just
that's Costco.
No. Can't get them at Costco. They did have one skinned hot dog at Costco for a while, but it was smoked and it really didn't taste good. But anyway, these Boar's Head, we have our dinner some nights is just the Boar's Head hot dogs. We fry them up, and I've got some Nathan's. Original Nathan spicy brown mustard, so it tastes like I'm eating out at Coney Island, you know. And man, these things are just the best. But I wanted to find out what you felt about skin hot dogs versus skinless hot dogs.
Oh, much better,
much better skinned.
So why are the preponderance of the hot dogs you find out there the skinless? Patrick,
history.
I'm gonna guess. It has to do, I mean, and we all know that the snap is the greatest part of it, but with the snap, you get hot juice as well. And my guess is that some of it has to do with kids eating hot dogs, and, you know, it's just easier to make. You know, the hot dog that we like, those are made with intestine casings. You know, I'm sure some of it has to do with kids and that snap. You know, and nobody gave a shit when I was a kid. I mean, if I had a hot dog that had a skin on it.
That's a hot dog when it's got that little crunch, you know?
Yes.
Now, you New Yorkers, at Sabret's, when you go to the Sabret's, they have a relish. And it's like a reddish color. Chili relish or something.
You haven't been to New York in a long time. I don't think they have Sabret's anymore. They have them as all they're left as are the carts on the corner.
Right. Well, that's where I used to get it, the carts.
Oh, okay.
And have you ever had it? They put on that relish?
No.
No?
I'm a mustard guy. Don't get me.
I'm a mustard guy.
They had onions. Dog.
Yeah, it's an onion chili.
Who gives a shit? It's a hot dog. You use mustard. Now, what I was saying to girlfriend, she was disagreeing with me, is that the skinless are best boiled.
Yeah.
Okay, and the skinned are best fried. Or not fried, but
grilled.
Grilled.
Well, on a pretzel, you put mustard. On a hot dog, you put the relish.
What kind of American are you?
What kind of idiot are you?
I put mustard on a pretzel.
Do you know something? That for years at the original Nathan's out in Coney Island. You, in the city, you could, but in Coney Island, you couldn't. You couldn't get coleslaw.
No.
And you couldn't get relish. It was just mustard and a goddamn fucking hot dog.
Well, mustard goes on that.
And all you other pussies can go into New York City, go to Times Square, go to the Nathan's there, and they'll even serve you a pizza, you pussy.
That's like here, McDonald's puts mustard on their burgers.
I don't mind the mustard. I hate ketchup.
Really? Oh, I love ketchup.
Ketchup is all sugar.
Ketchup goes on hamburgers. Mustard goes on hot dogs.
Yes.
Ketchup is good for French fries, but even better for French fries, believe it or not, I think, is mayonnaise.
Yeah.
I like
barbecue sauce. I like A1 or barbecue.
I like both.
Yeah.
How British of you, Alex.
How what?
If he was British, he'd be using vinegar.
Yeah, he's got mayonnaise.
Vinegar is very nice. When you get fish and chips and they put the vinegar on the chips.
It's a malt vinegar. Yeah.
It's a malt vinegar. It's very good. It's terrific. Is everybody getting suitably hungry now?
Last time you had a good
what?
Good knish. Looks
like you had a good knish.
Oh, I love knish.
Well, oddly enough, a couple of years ago, because there's a place right near where I used to live.
Yeah, I went to that place. Knish Notch.
Jonah Schimmel's, right? You know.
Oh yeah, Herbert Schimmel's. Yes, I went all. I took a whole bunch home.
Jonah Schimmel's is the best knish, probably in the world.
And it's so old. So
that place is. It's just, you know, you want to take the knish home. You almost don't want to eat it there. The place.
We got pictures on the wall too. You see that? Whoever went in there, I like that.
In San Francisco.
Oh, those are, you're right. Those are by far the best.
On Clement Street, you can get roots.
Listen, when it comes to Jewish New York deli food,
yeah,
fuck San Francisco. You know, yeah. I mean, anything there is an imitation.
Yeah.
Right. You know, compared to what you get here. Although, the day I finally went into a bagel store, they had a place called Bagel Nosh here.
Yeah.
And I saw the guys making bagels were Chinese. I said, it's all over.
Yeah, but they boil the bagels in New York. Out here, they make them like bread. This Noah's, that's not a real bagel.
No, it's not a bagel. It's a horrible. I used to tell them. It's a piece of bread. I would walk in there and I would go, this is no fucking bagel. This is like some doughy substance.
Yeah, so you get the Bialy, but we don't have bagels out here. You know,
is the water out? No,
we used to do bagels.
The water. They say it's the water. New York water.
Some of you saying that it was the water out there.
Yeah. Same with boilers in New York.
Best thing I used to do was when I get off the air at 6 o'clock in the morning here in New York City, get in my car because I used to drive around New York that time of day because you could.
Yeah.
And I would go over to H&H Bagels, which was just opening up, and I would buy them right after they made them, and they're hot.
Man.
Oh, man. And you would eat them, and they'd expand in your stomach.
That's good.
Oh,
good.
It was the best.
So, and you know what's a good bagel? Salt bagel. It's just like a pretzel.
Really? Yeah. He had a pretzel.
Now, we've been joined by Jack Bishop, but he's out of our league now in this discussion because I don't. Is there any black food equivalent of the bagel?
Hi, kids.
Hey,
oh, you got to go back to the game?
Yeah, halftime's over.
Oh, you fair weather friend. Jeez almighty. Nah. See you later.
Bye.
See you later, Patrick.
No, Patrick, he's got. Hey, Alex.
What?
You remember in San Francisco, TikToks, drive-ins? Oh,
I do remember TikToks.
There's still one around, I think.
I never went into it, but I remember seeing TikToks.
I spent half of my time in high school hanging out at a TikToks once I got a car.
Mm-hmm.
And I miss the TikTok cheeseburger because there was nothing like it.
Really? Well, Clown Alley.
Anyway.
Clown Alley?
Clown Alley sucked.
Yeah, well, they used to have a good patty melt. Their patty melt was excellent.
I always like patty melts.
What is it, like a cheese? Is that like a cheese?
It's a rye bread.
It's got rye bread.
It's rye bread. It's got a piece of meat, a hamburger meat on there. It's some cheese, usually what, Swiss?
Yeah.
That's the way to describe it. It's like a grilled cheese sandwich on rye with a hamburger in there.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Put it on the grill, and they put a weight on it, and it's pretty good.
It's very good.
They put butter on it, too.
They usually cut it in half for you. You know.
Okay, I would die for if I could get it here. Is that plain, simple deli potato salad. It doesn't have a lot of crap in it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I can't find a deli here that, you know, does that. They got the mustard, they got the mayonnaise, they got pickles.
It's oil and vinegar.
You went the German-style potatoes.
Yeah, oil and vinegar, German-style.
Yeah, there's some German-style, there's some German potato salad that passes for what I'm talking about, but just that same, that just basic vinegary potato salad. I've been trying to get that for 40 years here. Oh, can't find any deli that serves that. Even the ones that allege they are New York Jewish delis.
Oh, we have those here too. It's a big joke. New York deli. The only thing that's New York about it is they put up the Jets and the Giants and the Yankees. They put up the banners.
That's the one thing I would miss if I moved that
to New York. On the West Coast, they used to have Fairfax Avenue down in L.A., and they're still there. Cantor's and a couple of places like that, which were okay because what they were, they had some good, respectable New York Jews who would come in there because they'd become movie stars like Eddie Cantor and Al Jolson and so on. And so they couldn't exactly be shitty, okay? Yeah. But in San Francisco, I'm sorry, you couldn't get a good bagel. And in New York, you couldn't get a good loaf of sourdough French bread.
True.
I mean, sourdough French bread, it didn't travel well. And then finally, they figured out a way. The first way they made it travel, I remember when it first came out here, is they would send it unbaked. And then you would bake it at home. Okay. And that didn't work that well because, you know, you didn't have that kind of oven they have in San Francisco. And then not traveling well was when they tried to just send the whole loaf. Finally, when travel became faster and so on, they were able to get stuff here within a day and distributed. Now you can buy San Francisco sourdough French bread.
The yeast starter that they use for like Parisian bread and so forth is over 150 years old.
No, they kept using from the same pot.
Same thing,
to make the yeast, and it refurbishes itself.
Yep.
And
something about the altitude.
Well,
and
the reason the bread came to be was you had 49ers who had to eat outdoors a lot, and they kept these yeast pots with them in order to make the bread. And that's where the sourdough French bread came from. But folks, if you've never had real sourdough from San Francisco, it's to die for.
Yeah.
You know what else doesn't travel well? Lobster. You get lobster on the West Coast, you can't get yourself the kind of lobster you can get on the East Coast because somehow something happens to the lobster when they're traveling. You know, and by the time they get to California, they're bitter.
Jet lag.
They're pissed off.
What is the difference between... Okay, Phil and I are having a fight.
What do you mean? Where are you having a fight?
Talking
You're
about
in Hawaii
bagels.
And he's in Contra Costa.
We're having a fight because you said, I have a really good bagel place. And I sent it over to Phil.
How's the bagels down the street from me?
It's very good. And he said they're water bagels. And I said, yes, they're boiled. And he goes, but that's not the way they're supposed to be.
No,
right?
No. I said Noah's is not boiled. House of Bagels is very good. That's the real kind of bagel. But there's something different about a Bay Area bagel compared to a New York bagel.
It's water.
It's
quality to the water. There's something in the water. It's the water.
Yeah. In case people don't know, you take whatever they take bagel dough. And they throw it in boiling water, and they boil it.
Yeah,
really
they boil
what
the
happens,
bagels.
And then they quickly put it in an oven to give it a brown surface.
Right.
It's delicious, but it's the water that makes
it.
In
New York,
Jack.
Okay.
You know, I've got to run, but, you know, one of the things that you guys are not going to believe is how little good barbecue there is in Texas.
Really? You've got a Rudy's.
See, but barbecue is so...
I know you're going to say it's regional.
Bay Area barbecue.
But there are about three good barbecue places in the entire Dallas-Fort Worth area.
Well, I'll tell you, I was in Austin a few years back and taken to a barbecue place, and it was terrific.
Don't they pull the pork there instead of having it on a rib?
No, I pull the pork after the show.
It's a North Carolina.
Oh, it's like a shredded. Yeah.
You know, here it's beef is king, neighbor.
I was in High Point, North Carolina, and I walked into a barbecue place, and the girl says, "You want hush puppies?" And I said,
yes.
"What are hush puppies?" She said. They're hush puppies. You know?
Shecky and I traveling back here to New York from California, we stopped in, not Atlanta, Memphis.
Mm-hmm.
And we ate some barbecue there at one of their best barbecue places. I mean, he knew where he wanted to go because he had heard about this place. And it was pretty damn good.
Yeah.
You know. So I think that where you find great barbecue really isn't in Texas. You're going to find it in the Deep South somewhere.
Oh, okay.
You know?
Yeah, I mean, I've been looking for 40 years for consistently good barbecue in more than three places.
You probably get a great steak in your neck of the woods.
Oh, yeah,
right?
You get a great steak.
Yeah.
But when it comes to smoked meats, which is what barbecue really is.
Yeah.
You know, Butkus in a lot of places. Hey, I got to go to the internet.
Yeah, go do your show with Amy. She just left.
Isn't it Bupkus?
Hey, I don't know. You're the, you know, hey, look.
You gotta be a Schwarza, official kid.
You know, what am I supposed to know?
He's the Schwarza on the network. At least one quarter of our network is black.
Yeah. Well, you know, just Sammy Davis was Jewish. He could speak Yiddish.
Let's call it the minority show because it's also hosted by a woman as well. So,
you know, and a Jew.
And a Jew. So, you know. Well, no, we have enough Jew. Well, we only have one Jew. Now that I think about it.
No, wait. Don't you have Jewish descendancy?
Well, I got German descendancy, so I might jump up any minute and say, "Sieg Heil," or I'll cut you.
I thought there was a Trump joke in there, Jack.
No, I wasn't working that hard.
So you're part German and part what?
I am part German. I am part African. I am part English. Yeah. I am part Asian.
What are you, Hawaiian? Because when I met people in Hawaii, I met people that were like nine different parts something.
Alex.
I met a guy who's part Chinese, part Swedish, you know, part American cowboy.
So, Jack, being part German and part English, half of you wants to take the world over and the other half wants to screw it up.
No, one half of him wants to vote for Trump, and the other one wants to vote for Hillary. Anyway, thanks, Jack. I know you got a show to do. So I will let him go. Okay, and yes. You've been very quiet, Tony. Anything you want to join in and say?
Well, I'm actually enjoying the food talk, actually.
Yeah?
Actually, what I like is when my mother does buy crab, she actually cracks it out. The one thing I like how she does it is she'll take the meat out and put it in a sauce. I'll eat it like that if it's like on a sauce.
You are raised as crap.
I'll tell you what I was raised on.
That I enjoy.
My parents would stop by Fisherman's Wharf. This is back in the 50s, right? And 40s. And they would stop by Fisherman's Wharf. They'd get a couple of crack crab and get a loaf
from
of sourdough French bread, and my father would get himself a big jug of Dago red wine, right? Yeah. And we would sit down at the dinner table, cracking open the crab and eating it and dipping it in the sauce and eating the sourdough French bread, and that was the greatest dinner ever.
Yeah, the crab meat is nice outside when you get it out of it. I enjoy.
Yeah.
When crab season comes around, I'll go down to Fisherman's Wharf, pick up the crab, pick up the Parisian bread they got there, and bring it home. And
in my day, when I was a kid, that was a cheap dinner. How much does a crab cost now?
Isn't it expensive now?
You know, it depends on the time of year, but when you get on a Fisherman's Wharf, it's not that expensive. Really? $3-4 a pound?
Yeah, so how many pounds to a crab?
Two and a half.
Really? That's still that cheap, huh?
Yeah. Well, my parents used to you get it.
See, that's not fair because they didn't have a crab season last year. Right. So when you say how much did it cost, you couldn't buy it. You don't have enough money to buy it.
Yeah,
why
but the
didn't
year
they,
before,
why didn't they have a crab season last year? Is it a red tide or something?
No. Yeah, something like that. There was something about the crab had a
bacteria or fungus.
Bacteria, yeah.
Also, nobody goes fishing then because of that.
Well,
they're not allowed.
Well, they only sell crab during months with the R in it, I think, is the rule. And the reason they do that, the reason they've limited the fishing of it, is so that if they literally caught 12 months a year, they would.
I was told that they would run out of crab. Months with the R or that don't have the R, that there was something that the crab had some sort of issue that if you ate it, you get sick.
No, that isn't it. I had a girlfriend who actually was in the crab business. I called her Fish Princess. And she was in the crab business. Yeah. And she said that the reason why there are certain months they don't
fish for crabs because they want them
to regenerate themselves.
You heard of this claim to fame about certain months you don't eat it because
that it's not available. Not available. You can get crab all year long, okay? Right. But there are certain months you get the crab and it's been frozen and defrosted.
I see.
It's not as good. You know, yeah. Anything's been frozen or frosted is not as good, and it was not as good. So, you know, that's what all they wrote on that one. But anyway, that's all they wrote on this show tonight, I think. Am I running out of time? I certainly am. Yeah. Hey, it's been a nice night tonight, actually.
No politics.
No politics. Fish, good eating, talking about foods that don't travel well. And now we're all going to go out and probably eat our elbows. And the tropical pests, we should leave people with that. There's a rat there. There's a centipede. Thank you, Phil. Thank you, Renee. Thank you, Rob. Thank you, Anthony. Thank you to Patrick. Thank you, Amy. Thank you, Jack. And also a big thank you to James Lee with all his centipedes and his snails and
bugs. And
hey, you're great. Thanks for being with me tonight.
Good night.
See you again soon. Bye.
Bye.
Let me get rid of them all. Okay, and let me bring my camera up here so I can say goodnight to the TV people and everybody and say, as I always say, we'll see you on Tuesday. In the meantime, if you see her, tell her I love her, okay? And everybody out there watching the TV part of this, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I hope you enjoyed it. And there was a lot to see, too. We saw kitties and we saw snails and we saw all kinds of things. Have a nice night, everybody. And again, if you see her, tell her I love her. And we'll see you on Tuesday for the radio show, next Friday again for the video.